welcome you here this evening. It appears we've got another debate going on, so they're cutting our time. Imagine if there's on television. The agenda for this evening, we're going to start out, the candidates have already drawn for their order of speaking. Candidates will have a 7-minute presentation. Then we'll have questions from the audience, and I'd ask that there are no editorials, keep the question to 1 minute. And no multiple questions. Candidates will be selected at random to answer unless a specific candidate is asked, and they'll have a 2-minute time limit to answer the questions. Candidates then will speak in reverse order for a maximum of 5 minutes for the wrap-up. So this evening, Aleksandra has drawn number 1. Paul, I believe, is number 3. And Rick is number 2, so we'll call on Aleksandra.
Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Aleksandra Navarro, and I'm running to be your new Democrat MPP for Chatham-Kent-Essex and be a voice for people like you at Queen's Park. I'm a 29-year-old community activist that is passionate about finding progressive solutions to revitalizing our communities. I've been active in creating new opportunities for small and micro businesses in Chatham-Kent-Essex through co-founding a group called Power Women and Girls, where it's an organization comprised of women in media, business, activism, politics, and young women who want to be mentored from them. The group works together to support the endeavors of its members and the community and find outside-the-box solutions to challenges faced by businesses and the community. I am passionate about employment opportunities, job retraining, and to make our part of Ontario and its people as successful as we should be. With my educational background, I graduated from the University of Guelph with a Bachelor of Science in Agriculture and a major in Horticulture. I have an excellent understanding of the needs and issues of the agricultural part of our riding, the needs of the farmers in our community, which is close to a $3 billion industry in our area. I support viability in agriculture and affordable green energy solutions. I'm currently employed by MGS Horticultural in Bloomington. You may also know them as Morse Growers. And I'm a biological scout, meaning that I walk in houses looking for insects and diseases and let the growers know what issues are happening on their farms. I live in Bloomington, and last fall I ran for trustee for the public school board. I volunteer with the South Essex Community Council with disabled youth that engage in community activities. In this campaign, listening to the people of this riding, being accessible to hear their problems, concerns, and ideas for solutions has become one of the most important things to me. In a community that has long felt ignored and underserved by government heads in Toronto and Ottawa, I have made it my focus to hear the people. I often say that although one part of my job is to listen to people, the other part is to bring their concerns to the people in power. You know, this community has long accepted the way things are as the way they have to be. And this time, I'm providing a real choice to put change that puts people first and our community first. The groundswell support that has built up around me and the NDP platform here in Chatham-Kent-Essex is comprised of a lot of voters that until now were tired of politics, didn't believe their voice mattered, and now are excited again, or for the first time. Every day I'm speaking to people in our community who finally believe that somebody is listening to them, and this has further inspired me to, in my mission, to bring fresh change and fresh thinking to our community. We have so much potential here at Chatham-Kent-Essex, with an NDP, MPP in government, together we can demand the kind of representation that we deserve. I'm committed to outside-the-box thinking, to find solutions, and produce real change in Chatham-Kent-Essex that puts people first. So I realize that I have a little bit extra time, so I'm going to go through some of the key points in the platform for you, and that might be useful for you. Generally, the whole platform is around the idea of affordability and how life has become less and less affordable for people like you and me. As the cost of living goes up, wages are not going up at the same rate. So things that we're going to do to help your life become more affordable is, for example, take the HST off hydro and home heating and start taking that off gasoline. Put some protections at the pump from gas gouging so that you know what you're going to pay at the pump every week. Help people save for retirement. We have an Ontario retirement plan that would be excellent for people who don't have workplace pensions. Get electricity prices under control, and I will get into detail with that a little bit further on. We have many things for employment and protecting jobs. For example, stop the no-strings-attached corporate tax giveaways. And instead, what we want to do is reward job creators. We want to have a Buy Ontario program to build Ontario's economy. Ontario's natural resources won't be shipped away, and protect people on the job. We have a lot of great things with healthcare as well, and I'm just going through these quickly because I will go into detail later on as you ask questions. But we're going to cut emergency room wait times in half. We're going to ensure that dollars are invested in frontline healthcare, so that means doctors and nurses and people that actually take care of us. We're going to scrap the LINs, the local health integration networks. We're going to stop forcing patients to have to pay more when they go to the doctor in the hospital. We're going to meet the needs of an aging population, ensure everyone has a family doctor, and keep people healthy. And overall, this has all been costed. We are able to have these services that we deserve. Through the budget here, what we're going to do is restore the general corporate tax rate, which is going to help us bring more money to services, make temporary input tax credit restrictions permanent, cut consultants by half, hard cap on executive, government, CEO salaries and severances, cut waste and free funds for priorities with an expenditure management review, and a 20% reduction in home care administrative budget. So those are just some of the great things in our MEP platform, and I'm sure I will get into much more detail as the night goes on. So I'll leave it at that.
In all fairness to Rick and Paul, I already took mention of this to Alexandria. When I get up and come to the microphone, you've got 30 seconds. And Walt has got the stopwatch and he's talking.
I can tell.
Now I'd like to call on Rick Nichols.
Friends, did you know that the McGee government has created a $16.3 billion deficit, which is double the total of all the other nine provinces combined? Adult McGee told us twice in 2003 and again in 2007 that it would not raise taxes. The HST is costing families in Ontario at least $480 per year. Did you know that Adult McGee has overseen a 75% increase in hydro rates, and they're still climbing. Good evening, everyone. To begin with, I would like to thank the citizens of Orford and Highgate for allowing us to have this debate here this evening. Last time I was here was back in late April when you had your debate at the federal level here, so it's nice to be back. I also want to mention that you know I put on a great fair. I was here on Saturday, met a lot of wonderful people. Enjoyed the fair, learned a lot, met a lot of great people. And boy, you know how to cook up a fish fry, don't they? It's a lot of fun. Well, my name is Rick Nichols, and I'm a PC candidate for Chatham-Kent-Essex. You know, I've been working very hard over the last 4 months now, going door to door, canvassing. This is a pretty big ride, let me tell you. So I haven't been to your door, don't be offended, and don't take it personally. But I've been talking with Ontario families who work hard, they play by the rules, they expect to have more. God, you know what? But they have less. You may be able to relate to that comment. They constantly tell me how
difficult life is becoming for them. It's becoming more and more unaffordable. I was born and raised in Chatham, graduated from CCI. I don't forget whether we have any CCI grads this far east of the Rhine. I have a business administration and communication studies background. Together, my wife, Diane, and I have raised three great kids, but unfortunately, you know what? None of them live in a Rhine because they weren't able to find jobs. I've worked in a unionized truck assembly plant. I have a gas industry background, and for the last 25 years, I've been self-employed. I run a very successful training and development company, which has taken me throughout this ride, dealing with a lot of business and industry, talking with frontline workers as well as frontline supervisors, middle management, plus my travels have taken me across Canada throughout the U.S., talking with both large and small companies. You know, when I'm working with these companies, one of the major things that I'm working for is to improve their efficiencies, but to also keep them employed. That's primary. Friends, I'm here to say this to you. It's time for change. This election is about providing relief to Ontario families. A PC government will accomplish this by delivering immediate relief on home energy bills. You see, we conducted a Have Your Say Ontario online survey. We get tens of thousands of people throughout the province responding to this survey. And this is what they told us. I mentioned earlier, life is becoming unaffordable. They need relief on home and energy bills. So we will provide that relief by removing the provincial portion of the HST off of your home heating bills, off your home hydro bills. We will eliminate the debt retirement charge. We will keep the clean air benefit on there, which is 10%, which the Liberals put on because we forced them to put it on in the early beginnings. And smart meters, we will give you the opportunity to decide whether or not you want to maintain your smart meters. Maybe you want to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, doing your laundry, washing your dishes. We're also going to lower the tax burden on middle-class families by allowing couples to share up to $50,000 of income for tax purposes and giving a typical couple $476 in tax relief. We'll also lower the tax rates, personal tax rates, by 5% on the first $75,000 of taxable income. But here's something else very important. We will invest in healthcare and education. Those are two primary sectors that we are going to add to, not take away from, because it is critical. We'll also clean up the waste in government by getting rid of the fraud, the waste, and secret deals, by holding politicians, such as ourselves, and civil servants accountable. We'll also keep our neighborhoods safe. I know, and that would bother me too. We'll also keep our neighborhoods safe by toughening up on our treatment of criminals, by requiring prisoners to work up to 40 hours per week in manual labor. You know, one of the things I learned a long time ago, there ain't no free lunch. And we're going to use GPS technology to monitor drivers and sex offenders and other high-risk individuals as deemed by the court system. Someone said to me, Rick, what about seniors? I'm a senior. Why should I vote for you? I talked about income sharing with pensions. That's one reason why you should vote. We're going to think about HSP on home heating. I've already talked about that. That's another reason why you should vote. We talked about eliminating the debt retirement charge off your heating bills and a home hydro bills, rather. We've already talked about that. We're also, though, and this is important for you to know, we will balance the budget so that your grandkids, my grandkids, will not be crippled with debt. I mentioned at the very beginning that our province right now is in the deepest deficit it's had in its history, $16.3 billion. Now those are the soft numbers, but we will in fact be presenting more hard numbers later on. Friends, on October 6th, you have a choice. You can vote for more of the same, which is broken promises, increased taxes, continued private sector job loss, and secretive deals like the Samsung $7 billion boondoggle, or you can vote for a Tim Hudak-led PC government to be along with myself as your next MPP. We will bring that long overdue change and relief to the families of Chatham-Kent-Essex. Thank you.
Thank you to the citizens of Orford and Highgate for organizing this debate, and I see that there's people from Ridgetown and Howard here tonight as well, and probably from some other areas in Chatham. But thanks for coming out and taking your time to be here tonight. 8 months ago, I became a grandfather for the first time. Many here tonight know that being a father can bring pride as you see your children grow up and embark on their own adventures in life. But nothing really compares to becoming a grandfather. I see the future in my granddaughter's eyes, and it's a bright future, of that I have no doubt. That is why I'm running in this provincial election, to continue and build on the progress the Ontario Liberal Party has made as a government. Expanded daycare, full-day kindergarten, more vaccines for babies, more access to health care, tuition cuts for students, and risk management programs for our farmers. We have accomplished much together. What a difference the Liberal government has made to Chatham-Kent. Breast cancer screening at an earlier age with a new site at the Chatham-Kent Health Alliance, a new MRI for the Chatham Hospital, new family health teams in Chatham, Tilbury, and Ridgetown, where none existed before, $39 million in new funding for local roads, bridges, and recreation centers. Experience is important. For 15 years, I served my community as a municipal counselor. I served on both the Public General and St. Joseph Hospital boards. I was a municipal budget chair, and I served on the Board of Health. I have been an active volunteer. I have the experience needed to serve as your member of provincial parliament. Ontario Liberals know that the key to our province's future won't be found by looking backwards, it's forward together. Many people are looking for action on jobs. The Ontario Liberal Plan will create the new Southwestern Ontario Economic Development Fund, which will focus on job creation, expand opportunities, and attract new investment across Chatham-Kent. We'll invest $80 million over 4 years, starting in 2012, to strengthen this important Ontario region, we are. We count on our farmers, and Ontario Liberals believe that they should be able to count on us. We've committed to risk management and supporting our farmers, giving them the predictability, bankability, and stability they need to stay on the land. It is the most significant Made in Ontario agricultural program in over 25 years. We have asked and will continue to demand that the federal conservative government come to the table in support of Ontario farmers. We're cutting red tape by almost 28% through eliminating old, redundant regulations. And thanks to our tax reforms, farmers now only deal with one set of forms, one payment, and one point of contact instead of two. Ontario Liberals are committed to working with farmers to bring more Ontario food to the table. We have made record progress since 2003 when we first came into government. $80 million in support Ontario foods, or at least $80 million in support Ontario foods, 96% of the shoppers indicate that they recognize the food land Ontario local and report that they're buying more fresh Ontario foods than before. We're increasing the number of farmer markets in the province of Ontario. And for the future, we will support farmers to build and operate biodigesters to reduce waste disposal costs and to produce energy. We're going to create a bioeconomy fund to promote innovation and open up new markets for biofuels and other value-added sectors. New family health teams are coming to rural communities. Enhanced family health services for seniors. We're going to have home visits online and on phone. We're also providing support for food processors through the Rural Economic Development Program, and that will help provide, and is helping to provide better access to markets and to create jobs. We're also going to complete the upload of costs to municipalities. I was on on the Chatham-Kent Council during the Hugh Harris days when they downloaded social services on municipalities. There's only one taxpayer. When you download welfare and roads and other provincial roads and other provincial responsibilities onto the local taxpayers, it only means that your local taxes are going to go up or that your local services are going to be cut. Since the Liberals have been in power, we are uploading those costs, so we're taking municipal costs for those services back up to the provincial level where they belong, so that will help you maintain your municipalities to maintain their property taxes where they are. We've improved rural infrastructure with a permanent roads and bridges fund. And again, talking about the uploading, we're uploading $2.7 billion from municipalities, freeing up revenue budgets to invest in local priorities and to keep the property taxes under control. We're uploading costs for seniors' drugs, court security, social assistance, public health, and public transit. And we have a plan to upload an additional $550 million between now and 2018. So again, we're taking those expenses from the municipal level up to the provincial level where they belong, where the tax base is broader, so that you in the municipality can maintain more stable property taxes. We've also invested $62 billion in infrastructure since 2006. And we're going to spend another $35 billion over the next 3 years to help fix sewers and water mains and to improve recreation centers. It's very important that we keep our infrastructure up to date. You know that if the house, the roof of your house wears out, the damage that it's going to cost to repair is very, very significant. It's the same with maintaining our infrastructure. Only the Ontario Liberals have a plan to move our economy, to move our local economy forward. I was born and raised in this riding, and I've worked hard with other community-minded people to make our part of Ontario the best it can be. For families, for farmers, for small business, for students, and for seniors. I'm asking you to let me put my experience to work for you. My name's Paul Watson, and I'm running because I want to serve our community as your MPP, and I ask for your vote on October 6th.
Tonight. I will ask for questions in the audience once again. I stress it's 1 minute time limit on the question. Keep it to one question. The candidate will have 2 minutes to respond. You can pick the candidate that you want, or if there's no candidate connected, I'll just throw it open to the three candidates. So, any questions?
Hi, I have a question for Ms. Navarro. In your party platform, you described that there would be a tax increase on corporations and that your party would turn that money back to the population. That's socialism. That's wrong.
Now, the question was, with the corporate tax increase being a socialist type of a tax increase?
In fact, I wouldn't say it's socialist at all. Basically, what's happening in Ontario is we have the lowest corporate tax rates in the U.S., the average weighted average in the U.S., for most provinces in Canada. So we are at on average 28.5%, which is very low. What we are planning to do is to still ensure that our corporate tax rate still stays below the U.S. rates, okay? But with that increase, you're going to use that money to give these corporations incentives to create jobs. Because at the moment, what's happening is these corporations can do whatever they want with this money. They can sit on it. They can do anything. And they're not creating jobs. As you can see here in our riding and Chatham-Kent especially, like just us throwing money at them is not helping them to create jobs for us. So what we're planning to do is to create incentives for them to create employment, to invest in their machinery, their buildings, their equipment, and also invest in their employees.
Thank you.
I'd like to respond to that question. When we talk about corporations, we're not talking about big corporations. We're talking about small and medium-sized business. Many of you here are in have corporations as part of your business structure, whether you're farmers or small businessmen, even you know, even professionals like lawyers and accountants are incorporated these days. The idea of reducing your reducing the tax rate on small and medium-sized businesses, and which are often corporations, is to create jobs. We need to allow those small businesses to be productive, because we know we're not bringing any more huge factories into China. Again, we'd love to do that, but it's not going to come anytime soon. In the meantime, we're relying on small business to create jobs. They create most of the jobs in this province, and that's why we need to make sure that the tax rates are competitive. Ontario government is going step in step with the federal government and the tax reform and wanting to make more taxes for small and medium-sized businesses so that we can create jobs in those businesses. For those businesses can create jobs.
There we go.
To respond to that question, in order to attract business into this area, you know, friends, the Chatham-Kent area has lost over 3,800 jobs since 2005. And it may have affected either some of you here or, you know, people who have maybe other family members. And that's just not fair. It's not right. We need to attract business in this area. And by lowering corporate tax, that will induce businesses to come into our areas, whether it be in Highgate, Richtown, Glen, Chatham, wherever. We need to bring these people, we can get these companies in. We talked about some infrastructure. We also are looking at eliminating the red tape for these companies. One of the other things that the government is going to do is, you know what? We're fighting for these hydro rates right now. They're too costly. And one of the things that we will do is to fight to keep those rates down. I was talking with a small manufacturing company a few weeks ago. They employ about 24 people in Chatham. Small plastics company. Their hydro bill alone is $35,000 a month. And I look at that and go, wow, how much product do they have to produce just to cover their higher expenses? So we need to do things to attract business to this area.
Well, I don't know how much Mr. Watson knows about our platform, but we are talking about large corporations, and we do have incentives for small businesses where we are cutting taxes for small businesses for them to help get them started and get them going. Another thing is, he says that we won't see large businesses come back into this area. I mean, maybe under his government, maybe under Liberal government, which we've had for the past 16 years. And if we elect a Liberal government again, it will be 20 years that we have had a Liberal government in this riding. Is this really what we want?
Okay, another question. Yes.
This is in connection with, well, in particular, the 115-year-old heritage community of Kaiser's within the park that supports the local economy of Lemon Ridgetown and the area, and is a good lucrative source of revenue for the government itself. Now, I have a question on each one. Are you for or against the long-term lease extension for the heritage Kaiser community?
Okay, the question is to all the candidates, are you in favor of long-term?
Well, I'll answer that question. I can recall as a child in school, I remember the Rondo for the People Organization. This has been an ongoing battle between the bureaucrats and the Ministry of Natural Resources and the Rondo community for years and years now. I've always been in support of the Rondo community. When I was on the municipal council, the issue came forward the last time the leases were being renewed, and I was one of the councillors that put forward a motion of support for the Rondo community, and the leases were extended at that time. So yes, I'm in favor of seeing the leases extended. I know that there is real value, a huge economic value having the Rondo cottage community there. This is an ongoing fight with the bureaucrats in the ministry. Certainly, one of the first things I'll do as your new MPP is to talk to the Minister of Natural Resources and make it abundantly clear to him that we need to fix this, extend the leases. We've done it before, we need to do it again, and give some comfort to the people of Rondo.
It's a very challenging, interesting question. It's a very complex question, too, as I'm sure you're quite aware. I wish I could say that the answer is simply, yep. But you know, as you well know, there's many factors that we need to look at. As your MVP, I will sit down with the Rondo Cottage Association people, along with the federal as well as the provincial governments, the various ministries, to get the full picture, because you need the full picture. I will say this, though, that I do know that the Rondo Cottage Association and people who live down in those areas, I mean, there's a lot of good still on business which supports small business. And I think that that's important from an economic perspective. Blenheim and Bridgetown, people come in, they buy their groceries, you know, they go to the hardware stores, they go wherever, they even drive in blood and the rich don't get the pieces and take them back too, or else have them delivered. You know what, it's a much larger issue, but I definitely, because I do remember as a small boy as well, you know, the Rondo Park Pavilion, all those wonderful things out there. And as well as the mosquito, I remember those too. But I will say this, that as you mentioned, I will definitely sit down and work with all stakeholders involved to ensure that a proper, adequate, fair decision is made for all people. Thank you.
Okay, so this question has come up a few times, and I understand that the cottagers bring in a significant amount of revenue in our area, and especially since some of the cottagers are actually American, that they come here for the summers. And I feel that it would be a great idea for me to, I think it would be great to extend the leases. I am in favor of meeting with the stakeholders and meeting with the community and see what their wishes are.
Okay, another question. Yes.
How does the bargain back for you to point to our most small businesses and corporations and most likely to see during peak hours? How is it fair that the off-peak hours don't suit small businesses?
How is
it fair that the off-peak hours aren't suited to the majority of small businesses?
Is that directed to one candidate or all?
I didn't quite get it myself. The small businesses with the off-peak hours and the smart meters,
yes.
It doesn't seem quite fair because the small businesses that are open during the day, they're not open at night. So that's really fair.
Okay, good question. And I believe I understand where you're coming from on that. You know, small business is the driving force of the economy today. It truly is. And as a PC government, we need to make life even affordable for small business. And we're fighting those hydro costs even now. And one of the things that we will do is we'll make smart meters an option for small businesses. Right now, our little government has said, suck it in, tough it out, here it is. You've got your smart meters, and that's all there is to it. So during your regular business hours, you're paying 10.7 cents per kilowatt hour. That's simply not fair. It's forcing seniors to do their laundry and their dishes. know, at off hours, so they can save some money. I mean, many of our seniors are pensioners, and their income is restricted. It's not fair for them. It's also not fair for small business. And if BC government will give small business the option of going to a flatter rate, which will be lower, because that's when you do business, or if they choose to maintain those smart meters, that's their option. But at least now, you will have an option.
Yeah, so I have to agree. I mean, it doesn't make sense, and it's not helping small businesses. And I think what we should be doing is we should be helping small businesses and entrepreneurs if we want to stimulate our economy, especially in our riding. With respect to energy costs and energy bills, you know, some of the things that we're going to be doing that will be helping small businesses would be, for example, currently, you know, previously, Ontario Hydro was the main agency, the hydro agency, and after 1995, it got split into various agencies, meaning there's duplication of work, duplication of CEO salaries, and what the NDP wants to do is to end waste in our electricity system by merging these agencies and having CEO pay, and in the end, that should save us money, and that should help you with your business.
The smart meters are primarily a conservation issue, and you know, when I hear my conservative opponent talking about seniors, somebody getting up at 3 o'clock in the morning to do their laundry and wash their dishes, well, we know that's a ridiculous statement. Yes, the hours that are non-peak run from 7 o'clock in the evening to 7 o'clock in the morning, and all weekend. So certainly there are peak times, but the electricity, producing electricity is very expensive, and producing more electricity is very, very expensive. If we have to go out and build new nuclear plants to provide more electricity in this province, that's going to cost billions of dollars. Not only do you have the big cost of building the plant, then you have to transport that electricity. Nobody wants to have those nuclear plants close to them. If we build new ones, they would be built up, you know, probably the Bruce or Pickering area where they are now. Now we're going to need new transmission lines. So the idea is to push the, push a lot of the use of the electricity during peak hours in the daytime into the evening. So that, you know, that's the reason for the smart meters, and it allows people to do that. I can tell you that after years of neglect by the previous governments, both the Conservative and the NDP governments were in their power, they let the Ontario electricity system run down. And something had to be done then to fix it. A couple of things we're doing to help with the cost is that the Ontario Clean Energy Benefits, a 10% reduction in hydro bills for families, farmers, seniors, and small businesses, our property tax credits, $900 in annual relief for individuals and families, over 1,000 for seniors, and there are other funds available.
That's time. I was asked if we could have a rebuttal on that, but I think when the question is directed to one particular candidate, they can come back on a rebuttal. If you just keep track of the record and try to get it into your 5 minutes, champ.
I'll hear it.
Yeah,
I can start.
Somebody, okay.
Well, I have 150 questions, but I'm limited to one. We all know that taxes have escalated and continue to escalate for various reasons, and I hope somebody does something about it. But my concern at the present time, it appears that all parties are endeavoring to increase health services in this country to service the sick, when in actual fact, we should be teaching our children how to stay healthy and prevent these outrageous costs by the billions. What are you people, as the three representatives here tonight, planning on doing to make our country, our children, and present people involved in this country healthy again by attacking the prevention end as well as the healing end? Thank you.
Now, did everybody at the back hear that? Okay. We'll start with Aleksandra.
Absolutely, I agree. And I think that's one of that's very important. And I think it could save us a lot of money if we do ensure that our children and that our adults are healthy and we don't need to be spending money on care after something's gone wrong, but in fact spend it on how can we educate the public to stay healthy. One of the things we're going to do is we have a plan on fighting obesity and keeping people healthy. And basically it's geared towards children. We can start by providing support to new moms, ensuring mandatory physical education in secondary school classrooms, banning advertising of junk food aimed at children, and making calorie labeling on menus in large chain restaurants the law. So that's one of the things that could be useful, especially when children are growing and they're learning how to have healthy eating habits. And then overall, I mean, if we had more doctors that could also help with preventative care. And the way we will address the shortage of doctors is by forgiving student debt of new doctors who participate in underserviced communities, which will bring 200 new doctors over 4 years to communities in desperate need of new health care.
Well, certainly preventative health measures are a very central part of the Liberal Party health strategy. One of the things that we brought in is these family health teams, and I've had the opportunity to visit three of them now, being at Tilbury. I was at the one in Tilbury today. They had their 5-year anniversary, and there's two in Chatham now, the Chatham-Kent family health team, and the other one's called the Thames team. They're having an open house tomorrow. Preventative health is a big factor with respect to these family health teams. They have the ability to attract more doctors, but the doctors aren't being paid the same way. They're not being paid per patient, per visit per patient. They're being paid overall according to how many patients they have on their roster. So they now have incentives to keep their patients healthy, much more incentives than they did before. And it's amazing, these family health teams, the support they have, the dietitians, the social workers. The doctor was telling me yesterday that you used to tell his patient, you got to quit smoking. Well, you tell him to quit smoking, it doesn't work. Now he says, I'll send that person down the hallway to this counselor who will put him into a stop smoking program. Same sort of thing with someone that's overweight. He says, oh, you got to go on a diet. Well, now you can send them down the hall to a dietitian who will work with them on that. So that's probably one of the main areas. The other is that as far as our kids go, we've mandated that 20 minutes of daily physical activity. It's not mandatory in elementary schools. And we've banned trans fats from vending machines, school cafeterias, and tuck shops. And we've issued nutritional guidelines for food and beverages sold in schools.
Well, it kind of sounds like the Liberal government is actually increasing health care, but on the backs of our taxpayers, simply because, we're going to see this person, then they're going to send them down to the hall to see somebody, and they're going to send them down to the hall to see somebody else. And it's kind of like, that's increasing our health care. And to me, that's just not right. But to answer your questions about healthy habits, and I think that is really important. We will, as a government, will be investing an additional $6.1 billion in healthcare. Healthcare, friends, is the largest expense in any government out there. It truly is. Right now, our healthcare is about $47.3 billion. That's a lot of money. But one of the things that, we're not going to tell them exactly how to spend that money. But of course, we've heard about doctors or nurses, better medical equipment. That's important. But you know what, to answer your question about children, okay? You know what, I really believe that healthy habits begin at home. And I need to think that, it's the parents' responsibility to ensure that their children are, in fact, eating healthier. And let us start, let us all be an example of that. And that may be a hard thing to say, but you know what, I truly believe in that. But again, you know, from an education point of view, we're putting $2 billion in education. And you know, one of the things I remember, I'm sure as I look around here, many of us here, I've got 30 seconds. Now I have 20. Many of us here can remember back in high school, mandatory physical education classes from grade 9 up to at that time grade 13. And I really think, feel, and believe that, you know, we need to make those mandatory phys ed classes back, you know, put it back in the school system to help get our kids back in shape and to make them more conscious of their bodies and their health.
Another question.
Province has been on the side of eco energy grants for quite a while. It has benefited a lot of small business in the area. It's helped consumers upgrade their homes. What are your plans for those programs?
What are the plans of the candidates for the Eco Energy Program, the retrofit program that was in effect? We'll start out this time with Rick.
That our government is against is the eco taxes that are being paid by consumers today. However, the eco grants themselves, okay, I believe that's where you're coming from in that. What I like about them is that they stimulate the economy. They do help, you know, but I look at one of the recent going back to my memory here, the Liberal government is offering a relief to seniors, you know, $1,500 to retrofit their homes. That's really, it's 15% because it's based on $10,000. You know, that if you want to retrofit your home, you can spend $10,000 to make it safer or to do what you need to do. So it's a 15% rebate that they're going to be giving you back. And again, you know what, our biggest concern right now is the economy. We want to help people. We need to put more money back in the pockets of hardworking middle-class families right now. And of course, by doing so, that will afford people other opportunities. Again, do I like programs like that? Who wouldn't? But again, who's paying for that ultimately? It's on the backs of taxpayers as well.
Alexander?
So it is my impression that people making smart environmental choices deserve a break. And there are many great things in our environmental platform. I won't go through all of them because it's quite expensive. But you know, we have a lot of great things for people who want to retrofit their homes. Well, they'll also be saving money by conserving energy in their homes. We will be offering up to $5,000 in rebates for retrofitting your home. And I believe the federal government is also willing to put in another $5,000. So that's a significant amount. We also plan to phase out coal and maintain the FIT program, the Feed and Tariff program for homeowners, churches, farmers, small projects, and then bring on a lot more of the renewable energy online. Yeah, there's a lot more to that. I'm sure I'll get into that later on, but
Paul?
As you can see, my progressive conservative opponent's never seen a conservation program that he likes, or certainly that his party likes. And conservation, when it comes to home retrofits, conservation, that's what it's all about. Conservation is a very important part of our energy plan moving forward. And if you don't have plans to conserve energy, then electrical energy, we're going to have to build more capacity, and and that's going to cost a lot more money, and that's going to cause electricity rates to continue to go up. So that's why the Ontario Liberals did bring that plan into place. They have a four-year Ontario Home Energy Savings Plan. It helped the homeowners, it supported jobs, and it also improved our environment by, again, allowing us to reduce our dependency on the dirty coal-burning plants that we had to rely on in the past. We've closed down eight of those dirty coal-burning plants. The program did support over 354,000 energy efficiency retrofits, and it will save approximately $4.5 billion in lifetime energy costs. It also supported, and this is probably important to people around here, some of you, 9,400 jobs, and again, there's going to be a huge reduction in greenhouse gases. Unfortunately, what happened is that in March of 2010, the federal conservative government, they withdrew their funding from the program. So all of a sudden now we have a program that's only been half funded. The Ontario Liberal government kept that program going for another year until March of 2011. But at that point, the program funding for that particular program ended. So although the program has ended, we continue to fund half the cost of an energy audit if you do proceed to do a retrofit. And I'd like to see that program come back.
Actually, got a question from one of our web audience. They want to know, after there's hundreds of people caged up in Toronto during the G20, and there's still no public inquiry, will you fight for a public inquiry?
Question is, will you fight for a public inquiry in the people that are still jailed?
Not still, but they were.
Where jailed after the G20? Paul?
Yes.
Starting with Paul.
Some of the things that went on during the G20 were not appropriate. Certainly, the police on many occasions acted inappropriately. I don't see how any of that is going to be fixed by having a public inquiry. So, sure, to answer that question, you know.
Aleksandra.
Yeah, that's a really good question, and unfortunately, I guess my opponent couldn't answer that. I've heard a lot of many great horror stories about the G20, and the police did not act appropriately, and I don't understand why there is no public inquiry to that.
First of all, G20. I mean, it was a very serious event. This is where the world leaders are gathering and coming together. You know, you need to protect, you know, world leaders and say terrorism. We're concerned about that. Do I support the overuse of force? No, I don't. But how do I know when I'm confronted on a street whether an individual is just there to talk to me or take a swing at me? How do I know that? Well, if you don't like it, you know what? We have, you know, I am not in favor of being strong-armed by people, okay? Now, to support your question was what? On the, what will we do? Look at, have a general inquiry?
Will you fight for a public inquiry? Will you personally fight for it?
Before I... You want a hard, fast answer to that, and you know what, I'm not going to give you a hard, fast answer to it. I'll tell you what.
Because you're a politician. We want real answers, not your politics.
Yeah, it's just a big question.
Will you or will you not fight for it? Or do you believe in taking away the rights of citizens because politicians don't want to hear people exercising the democratic right? Because that's what it comes down to.
I will say this to you then, sir. There are ways in which to demonstrate and exercise your democratic rights. But when it comes to violence, whether it be people coming
in Toronto
or whether it be the police going out, that I don't support.
It is proven by thousands of feet of footage of the G20, that innocent, safe, calm people were kettled for no reason, and we need an inquiry to find out why that was allowed. That was wrong. That was taking away people's rights. And if you give up your rights, then you don't deserve any. And it's all about our rights as citizens in a democratic society to be able to protest peacefully. There are hundreds of stories of people. The gentleman losing his leg.
I understand. That's unfortunate.
That's
unfortunate.
In BC, they had the chance to vote on the GST. They turned it down. Are you in favor of having a vote on whether to continue the GST in Ontario?
Okay, the question is, are the candidates in favor of having an open vote to continue the GST in Ontario? Let's start with Aleksandra.
That's short.
Well, our policies are to take the HST off hydro, home heating, and start taking it off gasoline. Now, to take the HST off completely, I'm not sure what would have to be done in order to get that going. I have to say I'm not in favor of the HST, so I would have to look into what would we have to do to do that?
Rick. We had GST and BST. The provincial government formed the HST. They made a deal with the federal government. It's a five-year deal. If we were to take and eliminate the HST, it's going to cost Ontario billions of dollars to do so. Am I in favor of removing it? Not until 5 years is up, unfortunately. And we only had 3 years and about 10 months to go. Still a long time ago. The other thing is that currently, I mentioned earlier, sir, about our deficit being $16.3 billion. That is one way in which the Liberal government feels that they can try to recoup, you know, and help dig their way back out of the deep hole that they have us in currently.
Neither of my opponents, to be honest with you, both of their parties are very firm in the fact that they are not going to scrap the HST. So don't believe that there's any such plan anytime in the future. All three parties in Ontario support the HST. The HST is about tax reform. And tax reform is about jobs and jobs for our families and growth for our economy. As part of this tax reform, the Liberal government cut personal income taxes for 9 out of 10 Ontario families. We've taken 10% off of their hydro bill. We've created new tax credits for children's activities and seniors. We've made Ontario businesses more competitive, which is freeing up more dollars for investment in equipment and technology, creating, again, more jobs. We're further reducing the small business tax to 2%, and the 4%, I mean, I talked about earlier, for small business start. Also, we have a plan to reduce the tax rate on new investments by 55%. So, as distasteful as HST is, all parties are going to keep it. It did help Ontario's economy get back on track. We've already seen almost 90,000 new jobs created since HST was introduced, and our economy is outperforming expectations. You just have to look what's happening in the States and Europe to see that Ontario is doing much, much better than those countries.
Other question?
This one's directed at Paul. Paul, you mentioned that your party has closed 8 coal-burning hydro plants.
Yes.
And instead now we have, I don't know how many, but at least 500 in the county, wind turbines all over the place. I don't think that's a very good trade-off.
Well, I think it is a good trade-off. The clean energy economy is about cleaner, healthier air. It's about jobs and income. And it's about a more reliable electricity supply. As far as cleaner and healthier air goes, I don't know how many of you have heard the statistic, but 30% of the children in this province are in buffers. Buffers normally for asthma. I suspect it's much higher in Chatham-Kent-Essex. Certainly, my family was 100% because both of my children were in college. We have up to 5,000 smog related deaths a year in this province. That's a number of people, a village the size of Blenheim, just snuffed out because of bad air. So yes, besides that, there's all sorts of hidden costs with the alternatives. See, the alternatives to the clean energy is coal burning plants. So that's what was happening in the Conservative government. They ramped up the coal burning plants. Our air got through here. Smog became more and more of a problem. It's often referred to as being cheap and dirty. Alberta, they're going ahead and they're ramping up coal burning plants, but that's not the way we're going in Ontario. Our plan has been endorsed by David Suzuki, as well as Dr. Colby, our local medical officer of health. As far as jobs and income, the Clean Energy Act has already created 20,000 jobs. It's on track to create 50,000 jobs by 2012. That's about $20 billion of private investment into this province. A lot of that money is going to farmers, helping to diversify their farm incomes. I won't get to a reliable source of energy, but a little bit later.
Can he finish his question? He never
finished his question. The other question is, when you're short on hydro, you import it from the U.S., and that's 80% coal produced, and they're still building coal generating plants right left and center. So it doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense. You say, yes, we're using clean energy, but whenever we've got a shortage, we go buy it from them. You're just trading off whether the coal-fired plant is on Canadian soil or on U.S. soil.
I guess, Paul, I'll give you another minute.
Well, it's a whole question of showing leadership. Are we going to, how can we go down and tell the Americans to clean up their act and quit relying on their dirty coal burning plants if we're not prepared to show leadership and do it ourselves? That's my answer to that question. Yes, electricity flows all through North America on the grid. So yes, we sell electricity to Americans, yes, they sell it to us. It all averages out over time. But we need to show the leadership. We need to grow the clean energy economy. The Americans are going to, they'll be buying the technology from us. They won't have to go over to Europe to buy it.
Okay, now. You're good. Greg?
The beginning of government back in 2007 said that they were going to eliminate all coal burning generating stations. Interesting that in 2011 they're saying we're going to eliminate all the coal burning generating stations. In this particular area, coal burning is not the issue with regards to the air pollution. But you know what? A lot of the pollution comes from Michigan and the Ohio Valley. That's where a lot of it's coming from right now. Now, Mr. Watson indicated that that producing electricity is very expensive. He's absolutely right, it is, especially with the experiments that the Liberal government had been using on the backs of hardworking Ontario families. You know, we will close, as a PC government, we will close those coal burning generating stations by 2014. Another thing is that the energy, and of course clean energy, he talks about the number of jobs that have been created. I would challenge him on that.
So far, we've seen maybe 900 jobs throughout the province, but they're saying 50,000 jobs coming up. I need to challenge that. But here's something that I came across, and it's very important for us to know. You talked about the fact that we're buying from the state as well. From the beginning of government back in January, it was actually caught, okay, subsidizing other jurisdictions, like Quebec in the United States, to take in Ontario power. We had a surplus. And they actually paid Quebec and the United States over $1 billion to take our energy. And that's just not right. You know, these jurisdictions have been paying less. It's very elementary, Mr. Watson. When we take a look at, you know, we're paying 80 cents for energy, and yet you're subsidizing 80 cents for solar energy. And we, in fact, are only, you know, buying it for 5 cents. Any kid with a lemonade stand will know that you cannot buy a lemon for 80 cents and sell you the drinks for 5 cents.
Well, it is typical of the my opponent to pick examples that make it seem that aren't realistic examples. When it comes to the 80 cents, I'm talking about solar power. That's a new industry that is being developed in this area. Anytime you develop a new industry, there are going to be higher startup costs. But the money for these solar panels is going to the individuals and largely farmers that are producing electricity. 0.2%, now I'll repeat that, 0.2% of the electrical costs in this province are going to solar energy. That's a very small amount, but it's a very important industry that we need to build. Prices are already coming down. They've come down from 80 cents to 64 cents, and it'll continue to come down as we develop this industry. There are businesses that are popping up in this jurisdiction that are building solar panels, so they're creating jobs as well.
From a business point of view, who wouldn't want to be, you know, receiving 80 cents a kilowatt hour, or as Paul mentioned, 63-degree negotiating, because we realize the first price was pretty high to begin with. If it gets any lower, it won't be as lucrative, and probably won't be as many solar panels. However, as a PC government, here's what we will do. Because I told them, I said, you need to talk to the Ontario Power Authority, and they need to talk to Hydro One. And before you had invested, you needed to, you know, check it out, because we can't help you. We need to invest in five, and we'll get two up there. Now, the other thing is that we will honor, okay, a PC government, any contracts, even if there are people in the audience tonight, and you already have conditional contracts for solar, or even, you know, for solar panels, as an example, we will honor that. Even though they may not even be out, as long as you have a conditional contract, it'll be fine. I think your contracts are 20 years, I believe, and 20, 25 years. Not to worry, you will be okay. But it's your responsibility to get them hooked up to the grid. If you can't get them hooked up, then just be wise, okay? If you have a grid, or if you have a conditional contract, make sure you can get it hooked up before you actually buy them. We'll say here, because farmers, they work hard for your money, and we don't want to see your money go down the drain. So that's one of the things that we will do.
Tiger, Paul.
You better be pretty careful if you're going to trust that assurance. The PC party has indicated that they are going to kill the Green Energy Act, and when that happens, the windmills and the solar panels that go with it are also going to be killed. This is a serious problem. The question was, what would I do to help solve it? I already have spoken to the Minister of Energy, Brad Duguid. He meets weekly with the hydro officials. He's told them to fix this problem, to make it a priority. All I can say is I wish it would happen a lot faster. I know that this is an ongoing problem. I met a family and two families in Tilbury that are having a similar problem. It's a glitch, but it's a serious glitch. It's not a government contract, as many people indicated. As I understand it, we got two branches of Ontario Hydro, being Ontario Power Authority, which went and okayed the projects, and then Ontario or Hydro One said, no, we don't have enough capacity on the grid. So it isn't. One of the things that has to be done is to upgrade the capacity on the grid. One of the priorities is to build a new power line south of London that's going to go through southwestern Ontario, but that's not going to solve the problem in the short run. In the short run, we need to continue to pressure the hydro company to fix this problem and get these solar panels on the grid. It's got to be done, and it will be. It's taking much longer than it should.
Another question.
Has the government thought of replacing these coal-fired buildings for natural gas? I realize that it costs a lot to transfer it over, but we do have lots of natural gas, and it's clean air. Now, we're in Michigan sometimes, and we always cross the ferry, and we were coming in to cross the river from Cartwright, and in 14 or 15 miles, I counted 14 coal-fired in Michigan. Within 14 miles of where ours is, I mean, is this side. So how do they think they're going to correct that when the wind blows it over across from Michigan?
The question is, what's the government's position on replacing the coal-fired plants with natural gas? We'll start with Greg.
Again, I think that we need to look at the feasibility of how we produce how we produce our energy. It's critical. Nuclear is obviously one of the cheaper, as well as coal. We have committed to eliminating coal burning generating stations by 2014. One of the things that we also need to look at, though, is with natural gas, being an old gas guy, you know, it's clean. But we need to make sure that when we're producing energy, that it needs to be economically affordable for our taxpayers, because ultimately the tax burden for, you know, falls on the shoulders of every one of us in this room. And of course, we will ensure that that in fact renewable energy and the use of natural gas, you know, would be affordable. I know they're looking at that right now with the Atlanta Generating Station, and it's probably a very viable way to look at it as well.
So in our environmental platform, we always say, you know, we want to have affordable green energy choices. And so what that means is, I mean, obviously, we need to phase out coal as opposed to just removing. And so that's one of the things that we have planned, we have set out to do, is to phase out coal, maintain the FIT program, like I had mentioned previously, with smaller projects like homeowners, churches, farmers, community-based projects, and we plan to expand the ability of community-based organizations to become significant power producers, as well mandate Ontario's publicly owned power generator to engage in an ambitious program of large-scale renewable energy projects in Ontario, creating a sustained demand for products and services from Ontario-based renewable energy companies. So I mean, that's just one of the ways that we plan to move away from coal and into something more green.
You raise a very good point about the coal burning plants over in the States. And that's what I was talking about earlier when I talked about showing leadership. We in Ontario, as a government and as citizens, need to be telling our American friends that this is not acceptable. It's not acceptable for you to be sending your dirty air across the borders into our country. We can't go and tell them to clean up their act until we clean up our act. So we need to show leadership by reducing our reliability on the coal burning plants. And we will phase out all the coal burning plants by 2014. With respect to the question about using natural gas, yes, that is part of the mix. There are a number of the plants are being, not necessarily converted, but certainly natural gas burning electricity plants is part of the mix. They're very efficient for dealing with the peaks and balances. When you have nuclear power, it's steady all the time. You know, you can't turn them up and down. But with natural gas, you can fire it up when you need them during the high peak periods in the summertime in particular. And you know, those are times when you don't want to be pouring lots of pollution out in the air either from the coal burning plants. You can fire them up in the summer when you need them, and you can shut them down again. So the gas burning plants are part of the mix. The idea is we have to keep pushing out the need to increase the capacity, because the other alternatives, and you know, nuclear is one of the alternatives. It certainly isn't cheap. Certainly has environmental concerns, and the big cost is running more transmission lines from all across the province from those plants. So the more we can push off that need, the longer we can keep our electricity prices at a reasonable rate.
Particular candidate or all three?
All.
cuts from the Harris Hewitt government case, the downloading was severe. When you download social services such as welfare on municipalities, when you go and download the upkeep of roads and bridges that were previously under provincial jurisdiction, we have lots and lots of bridges in Chatham-Kent. When you download those sort of services onto the property tax base, then it causes property taxes to go up and services to go down. And that's exactly what happened with the libraries. It wasn't the provincial governments that were cutting the support to the libraries, it was the municipalities because they didn't have any choice. The McGuinty government has entered into an agreement with the province to upload billions of dollars of costs back where they should be at the provincial level. Mr. Hudak, when he was asked back in the summertime at the AMO convention whether he was going to support that agreement, he said no. So we know that the Conservatives get in, they're going to start all over again. They're going to kill that agreement, and the costs are going to go back down onto the municipal taxpayers. So really, that's the solution to the problem. It's not direct support from the province to libraries. We have to give the municipalities the ability to support their libraries, and the way to do that is to ensure that the municipalities are spending their money on things that are their responsibility, like libraries, and not social services, provincial roads, and bridges.
Correct. Well, if I were to just, first of all, that he keeps referring to the PC government, Mr. Harris Hudak, that's living in the past. I respect the fact that cuts were made back in the Harris government. You need to understand also, if you want to go back in history, that we also inherited an NDP crisis in our province right now. And of course, with Bob Ray, that was one of the major reasons why Tim, or rather, Mr. Harris, I said, listen, this is what I will do if elected. And you know what, he did what he said he would do. And of course, that ended up with two majority governments. Then you talk about uploading and downloading and so on and so forth. You know, the Liberal government have a real history of buying votes. And I want to explain that to you here. Mr. Watson has talked about the downloading onto municipalities. Well, one of the things that an Ontario PC government will do is we will honor the $1 billion in uploading that municipalities currently receive. We'll take that on. We will honor that. We're not going to download anything to them in that regard. Municipalities will continue to benefit the $1 billion in uploading under a Hudak government. Adult McGuinty has spent the last 8 years driving up costs for municipalities through his broken arbitration system and hitting them with his HST grab. His only advice to municipalities is deal with it. And what does he do? In dealing with it, he raises taxes. Dalton McGuinty, can you stand for one?
3 seconds.
Oh, okay. I'm so good. Dalton McGuinty has also dumped the smells of municipalities by stripping away their say whether industrial wind farms can be placed in the communities. This is this whole thing about uploading and downloading. But I will say this, that you know what? Downloading on municipalities, we need to take a look at the finances of our province before we start downloading or accepting uploading. Because it, again, it bears to the ability of the taxpayer to pay. If we can't pay, then we have to take it seriously.
I think there still are a lot of problems that people are struggling with from the Harris government. And a lot of cuts were made, and you know what, those services never received that funding back. And as many of you know, the NDP is a party that actually cares to fund services and make sure that we have the services that we need in order to succeed. Not only libraries, but things like healthcare, like schooling, trying to eliminate poverty and so on and so forth. And there's a comment I wanted to make about the NDP, right. What was it that the NDP did 20 years ago? I was 9 years old. Yeah, I don't remember. Anyway. Yeah, so, I mean, we don't have anything specifically in our platform to libraries, but that's one of the things that I would be certainly willing to work with you and bring those concerns up to Queens Park, because that's what I think we need here in our ridings. We need representation here that listens to the people here and their concerns and brings those concerns up to the people in power instead of the other way around.
Any other questions?
Yeah, I'm trying to think of what this is really about. On the meeting, there's green energy out of that. We're getting excited. A lot of industrial wind turbines. Wherever they've sited near residences, just about anywhere in the world, there's been an average appreciation of the value of the property sited near them, 5 to 40%. We have market value assessment for all residences and the municipality, this one and others around. If we get a lot of industrial wind turbines in here and our market value assessment drops, that means we pay less residential tax. Less money for the costs for services in the county. Our provincial governments, anyone that's elected here, going to offset that loss of tax revenue to the county and pick it up. That's the market value assessment of people's costs in the county.
Okay, the question was, industrial wind turbines seem to the value of property value, which in turn will drop the assessment. Are the parties willing to top that up? The assessment goes down, the revenue for the county goes down. Are the parties willing to top that up to the level that it is? Start with Aleksandra.
No.
Okay, I hear what you're saying. Values go down because of the windmills, the wind turbines.
It runs between 25 and 40%.
25 to 40% lower. Oh, okay. Well, that's really interesting, and I would love to speak with you about that. I have to say, you know what, I'm honest, I don't know whether we could do that for you, but you know what, if we're all using your power and it happens to be close to your land and you're losing money on it, then it's
definitely
something that we should look into.
Going to take money from the roads, gravel, and everything else.
Right.
If I'm paid on what my place is worth,
right,
it's just value, there's less money going to the bottom of the office to be able to provide these services.
Right.
Okay, I found the article I was looking for. Ontario farm property values at record levels, contrary to claims by opponents to wind energy. This was recently reported by the. It was reported in a news agency, a news report, September 14th, 2011, of Ottawa. The Canadian Wind Energy Association today welcomed news that the majority of Ontario's agricultural regions have enjoyed a significant increase in prices of farmland over 2010 prices. And then they're referring to the REMAX Market Trends Report, Farm Edition 2011. It's promising to hear that the value of agricultural property has increased in most regions of Ontario, especially in areas like Chatham-Kent and Windsor-Essex, where wind energy has also enjoyed significant growth over the past few years, said Chris Forrest, Vice President of Communications with CAN-WEA. This would seem to run contrary to claims made by opponents that wind energy has decreased property values. Chatham-Kent, for example, has enjoyed a significant increase in farmland value in 2011, while also seeing several new wind farms come online. I know this personally. I'm a lawyer. I've acted on transactions where farmland in Chatham-Kent is selling over $10,000. In some areas, it's gone up to $15,000. There's no truth to any suggestion that the wind towers is causing property values to go down. In fact, the evidence is they continue to go up, and the farmers that are getting revenue from those wind towers, they're getting extra income. They're not asking for more money.
You know, industrial wind turbines is a hot, very hot topic in this area, as we all know. Here's how I see it. Double-edged sword I mentioned earlier about, you know, from a business point of view, you know, it's very lucrative. Now, this article that he talked about, can we have a Canadian Wind Energy Association, they have a vested interest in this, spec friends, and it's their article. Okay, so it's that's marketing, and I understand that. However, one of the things that I'm very concerned about is as I drive through, especially down in my area, I'm a Chatham boy, but you know, down through Merlin area and Highway 3, I see these wind turbines, these wind farms all over the place. And I look at it, and I know that they're earning, that the farmers are getting, what is it? Help me, anybody here have one on their farm? Turbine on their farm? I believe it's $10,000 to $12,000 per turbine on their farm. Now, from a business point of view, hey, that's all right. Take some of my land and put this turbine on it. The way I look at it is it's actually decreasing their value of their property, but they're getting subsidized for the decrease in their property by receiving $10,000 to $12,000 per turbine on their property. Now, here's another thing that concerns me. A lot of people that live out by the lake are there for a reason, because they want to be out by the lake. Now, they also pay very high property taxes. They don't have these turbines on their property. However, these turbines are in fact decreasing their property value because of the fact that people don't want to buy those beautiful homes along the lake, perhaps, and look out the front door and see nothing but wind farms. There's also another issue here, and that's maybe a health issue that I'm concerned about, but they haven't got adequate studies done on it, and I trust you. Believe me, we will, as the BC government, look further into those health issues. Ask the agricultural community. They are telling us that there are effects on livestock even today.
Any other questions?
I've been with the Local Meals on Wheels program probably back since 1984. The last two or three years I've been in the program with the Lindsay Bowl. It has turned into the most, it's horrendous. The bureaucracy, the red tape, and I mean, nobody answers to anybody, even to the point of funding, and we are scrambling, and we speak a lot of people in this area, and we're close to having this to shut down because we can't get answers or money from anybody. What's your opinion? Are you going to do to straighten out the limbs so that our local programs can continue to operate? Because we got to make it possible locally. And it's not just the Meals and Wheels program. I've heard from a lot of the other ones.
Did everybody hear that?
There's a problem with the limbs, which is through the Ministry of Health. They fund the local Meals on Wheels program. They're supposed to. It has turned into a major bureaucracy with red tape. All we do is fill out paperwork. And we can't pay our bills right now because they won't listen. I spent last week on the phone with seven different people and couldn't get an answer. We need to get this straightened out. And we aren't the only small organization that gets our funding through there now. It's a mess. And I want to know what all three of the candidates here are going to do to straighten out.
Okay, we'll start with Paul. I'll let you.
Well, the lens are about the lens are about streamlining these services that are being provided and keeping the decision making local. The lens allow local healthcare decisions to be made here at home by you, your friends, and your neighbors because the lens are local. You're not in Toronto, the Ministry of Health, where they used to be. It's also, they've saved money by replacing 51 overlapping bureaucratic organizations, and the Ministry of Health Administration is now half of what it used to be. The local LIN has taken 136 different local agencies, including various Meals on Wheels programs in different communities. They brought them all under their roof, and they're now administering those programs. The whole idea was to, and it is to bring that decision-making locally, to stop the overlap that was happening with these 136 local agencies, and that will keep the cost down. I've spoken to the executive director of the LEND. I know that they're working with various Meals on Wheels programs. If that one is, if you're having specific problems, I'd certainly be willing to speak to Mr. Switzer about that. But I know that in my last conversation with him, there was some issue that came up with respect to some of the local Meals on Wheels and what happened between some of the different organizations. They certainly, they want to work with you. I know that that's part of their mandate, and I think it's just a matter of sorting through this particular problem. It's certainly, certainly bureaucratic problems do arise anytime you deal with any form of government. And that's one of the things that an NPP has to help out with.
You know, Meals on Wheels is a very valuable service to the community. They do tremendous work for a lot of people. It's unfortunate that they're getting frustrated with what's going on. PC government have a mandate. We talked about increasing our health care by an additional $6.1 billion. And how that will be divvied out, that remains to be seen as to how we will do it. But here's one thing I will tell you. Currently, within the provincial government, there are 630 agencies, boards, and commissions. We have committed to look into every one of those agency boards and commissions with one simple mandate in mind. If they're working well, we will leave them alone. If they're broken, then we're going to try our best to fix it. But if they cannot justify themselves, they're gone. And I will go on record and tell you this tonight, that a BC government will eliminate the LINs. They will exist no more, as well as the Ontario Power Authority. The LINs in this, over the last 4 years since the Liberal government, I mean, he talks about streamlining, question that. He talks about local health decisions. I'll touch on that, but the LINs have cost taxpayers in Ontario over the last 4 years over $300 million. That's just not fair. We will put that money back into healthcare. And of course, we will hold CEOs of hospitals more accountable. They make a big dollar, and they deserve to be held more accountable in terms of how they operate their hospitals and how better services within our community can be provided.
The NDP is determined to put taxpayers' money into frontline healthcare. We need to keep rural emergency rooms open and reduce wait times. We need to change the attitude that one size fits all for rural Ontario that has special needs that aren't being addressed. Closing beds, forcing patients to get basic treatment miles from home when short-term care in local hospitals is more practical and efficient. The local health integration networks have not worked well and are very expensive, as we know, in Chatham-Kent-Essex, are an arm's length government agency to implement government plans without political accountability. We will scrap the LINs and replace them with effective local decision making.
Okay, anybody else? I need a microphone. Sorry. I don't have a loud voice, so I'll use the microphone. I work with Rick Nichols as well as the gentleman down here, Aleksandra. In Ontario, we've lost 340,000 manufacturing jobs since 2004. So hydro consumption's way down. We're overproducing electricity now. Windmills, when they spin, the grid is required to take that electricity. Last year, January 1st and January 2nd, we overproduced in Ontario.
Are we going to get a speech from the president of the local PC Association? Is that what this is all about?
We overproduced over enough electricity to export to New York and to Quebec to the tune of $6 billion it cost the taxpayers. Yesterday, Mr. McGinty announced that he was scrapping the Mississauga power plant, which was going to be gas.
Now, when do we get the question? I object to the process here.
Okay, can I just make a comment since you pointed something out? Yes, I do work with Aleksandra. The question that came from me, although yes, I am involved in it myself, it again was from our web audience, not from myself. Just letting you know.
I don't think there's any question there. I'm hearing it as a lecture.
There was no question.
There's no question.
You had your 1 minute. You had your 1 minute. There is no question.
There's no question. I do have a question. Finish.
Yeah, but you have 1 minute.
All right.
At the beginning of the election on here, PC Darwin said that they wanted to add humiliation to punishment with prisoners in the penal system. They want to get chain gangs into our parks, displace the workers that do that work. We want to get chain gangs on our school park ground. I want to know if the conservative government still is going to continue with that policy, and I want to know if the other two parties believe in rehabilitation, and if so, how. Well, the first part, and then
okay.
As to whether
you can start
following through with that.
Boy, I'm telling you, Dr. Stein, and that's over, you're really going to like me.
It's your policies I have to like, I don't have to like you.
That's okay. It goes both ways. You know, we actually, we're probably pretty good.
Well, if we're here voting for policies.
Okay.
All right, you know, to answer your question, you used some pretty harsh language when you said humiliation.
Well, it is a form of public humiliation.
I understand it, sir. Let me mention something here, though. One of the things that the PC government is going to do is we're going to get tough on crime. I mentioned earlier this evening that there was no free lunch. And we mentioned earlier that we were going to be forcing provincial prisoners, which means 2 years less a day, not hardened criminals, and the liberals made it out like it was like hardened chain gangs. And you think of chain gangs, you know, in our community, you think of chain gangs down south. So that's a long picture that's been painted here, okay? But if they, you know, we want them to pay back to society because they've taken from society. They've taken from you, they've taken from me. And I believe that they need to be, rather than just placed in jail cells and wait out their time, we need to put them to work to pay back to society. Now another thing though, because I want to add this, is, you know, there was an issue down in Leamington, and we talked about sex offenders, okay? And these kind of, they're similar, but they're different. But with the sex offenders, I want to know in my community whether or not I have a registered sex offender. And we will put GPS bracelets on these registered sex offenders and have an online registered sex offender registered so that we can, in fact, you know where these people are at all times. We need to keep our communities safe.
Well, I'm very surprised that my PC opponent brings up Leamington again. When Mr. Hudak was in Leamington, he decided to make a political issue for his own gain with respect to this issue that my friend just spoke about. They went to the family members that had suffered as a result of this young girl that had been sexually assaulted. And they didn't want to get involved with it. They didn't want to be part of the dog and pony show, so they said no. So what do? They go to the back of their bus and find a couple of people that, I'm not using that literally, but they found some people that didn't have anything to do with this group. They put them out front and did the big interview and said, you know, this is our crime and punishment policy. We're going to use these people as props. It blew up in their faces. The community of Leamington was very insulted by Mr. Hudak using this issue for his own personal gain. It is a serious issue, but putting GPSs on individuals that are on a sex registry has been proven to be unworkable. Experts in the states have commented on this. It's a ridiculous program. It's not going to work. The police are already keeping a good eye on these people. Does there need to be more disclosure from the police? Well, perhaps that's another issue. But see, you can't go and start branding these people that have been in prison and are being released again. They have to live somewhere. After you've done your time, are you not entitled to go back in the community and live in the community and work in the community? It's passing the buck, I guess, if you say, well, they can't be in my community, but they mean somebody else's community. So our crime and justice position would certainly put more peace in the street, but the HUDAC plan that put prisoners in the parks, that is just, I don't like being this.
As I've said in a previous debate, apparently now you have to call 911, call yourself in to get a job. And the worst part is that this program is actually going to cost us money to put these prisoners out there and pick up garbage and mow lawns and whatnot. And these are actually jobs that people can be doing. These can be summer jobs for students.
I'll take the job.
Yeah, here's someone right here who would love to have a job like that, but unfortunately is unemployed because he lives in Chatham-Kent. There's no jobs in Chatham-Kent. So, you know, I think instead we should be using money or resources, investing in prisoners for rehabilitation, because these prisoners will eventually come out of prison and they will have to reintegrate with society and they will want to get a job and they will want to be integrated with the rest of the community. So I think that's the direction that we need to go.
Since I get a rebuttal, because the gentleman did direct it to me initially, I just want to point out one thing here. I wish my opponents, both of them, would get the facts straight about Leamington. They weren't there. I was there. I was there when the protesters, you know, were at that school, at St. Louis School. Myself and my colleague from Essex were giving a press release at that time. These ladies were there. They were interviewed. They had their time. Now, they came along after the fact. Fact is that the people that were there were concerned parents. We had a husband and wife. We had another concerned mother. And we had another couple of concerned grandparents. They were members of that community. They cared about their community. They were concerned. We talk about a staged event, dog and pony show. I'll talk about dog and pony shows, Mr. Watson. If you want to talk about solar panels and Mr. McGinty, and you've never once used Mr. McGinty's name.
You know, it sounds like an awful lot of excuses to me that you're putting forward.
You're going
to
read
the newspaper, and that's exactly what happened.
That's what you read in the newspaper.
Okay.
I'm responsible journalism, and I don't care what you have to say about that.
Okay.
This is what you get.
Oh, we got that on our chest now. You feel better, Paul?
You got 5 minutes for your closing argument. And we'll do it in reverse order, so we'll start with Paul Watson.
Thank you once again to everybody for being here. When the Liberal government launched our drug reforms, we had one goal in mind: fair drug prices for you and your family, because that's what you expect and deserve. We cut the prices paid for generic drugs by 50%. We're using the savings to add 186 new drugs to the public drug plan. And because of the actions that we took, local seniors have better pharmacy services and easier access to medication. We're auditing pharmacies and we'll take action if any pharmacy fails to follow the new rules. Ontario Liberals are the only party to support lowering the cost of generic drugs for your families. The UDAC Progressive Conservatives voted against our reforms, and they support the big drugstore chains campaign for higher drug prices. In fact, it's known that Mr. Hudak himself has shares in Shoppers Drug Mart. And his campaign manager, Mark Spiro, was the lobbyist for Big Pharmacy, and they were leading the campaign against lowering drug prices. The NDP also voted against the legislation that saved taxpayers hundreds of millions of dollars every year. And the NDP did not have a plan to lower the cost of generic drugs for material families. Ontario Liberals are the only party absolutely committed to building the most educated workforce in the world, from full-day kindergarten to university, college, and apprenticeships. Bridgetown College is a better place since the Liberals came to power. It's expanded with new buildings to attract any more students. That was part of a $4 billion investment in new classrooms and labs across Ontario. Ontario Liberals are committed to create 60,000 more spaces in addition to the 200,000 new spaces that we've already created in college and universities, and we are implementing a 30% tuition cut for post-secondary students. Bridgetown District High School is still open because of Liberal policies. At the PCs are in power, and now we're planning an empty building. We say the schools that we're closing, we got them open, the Conservatives closed them. As I indicated earlier, I was born and raised in this riding. My father was in Thamesville, which is now in the riding next door. My mother was raised in Ridgetown, and I spent my entire life in Chatham-Kent, except for the time that I was away going to school in London, Ottawa, and Toronto. So I've worked hard in this community with other community-minded people to make our part of Ontario the best it can be. And I've done that through the involvement I've had in my 15 years of council, my involvement with the hospital boards, with the health board, with the volunteer groups that I'm involved with, 11 years as a big brother, member of the Rotary Club. They do a lot of community work and international work. Past member of the Kinsmen. I've worked with those clubs, I've worked with Bingos. I'm part of this community. So I'm here for your families, I'm here for farmers, I'm here for small business, for students, and for seniors. I'm asking you to let me put my experience to work for you. I'm running because I want to serve our community as your MPP, and once again I ask that you support me on election day. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, again, I'd like to thank the citizens of Orford and Highgate for allowing us to have this debate tonight. Friends, families must live within their means and make choices to balance their budgets. Government should be no different. The economic uncertainty of the past few years is no excuse for Dalton McGuinty's irresponsible binge of reckless spending and further taxing. Let us not forget HST, Ecofee, tire taxes, smart meter scandal, skyrocketing hydro rates, failed green energy experiments, delisting OHIP health services such as optometry, chiropractors, and physiotherapy services. Let's talk about the OLG scandal, where it costs millions of dollars to remove the C from OLG, previously C. How about Ontario tuition fees being the highest in Canada? They talked about reducing tuition fees by 30%, but that's because it's 40% higher than anywhere else in Canada. How about the $45,000 severance packages for tax collectors switching their job titles from provincial to federal to collect HST tax? They didn't miss one day of work. And the latest $10,000 affirmative action subsidy that disadvantages every Ontario worker who has lived in Ontario longer than 5 years. Ontarians need not apply. What's next? A carbon tax? Of recent, yes, we've heard about that. Could there also be another increase in the HST of 2% that the McGuinty government get back in? Be careful. Friends, for Ontario, we must make decisions necessary to balance the budget in a very responsible way. It is possible, but realistically, friends, it's not going to be easy. After all, there's at least a $16.3 billion deficit in it, and that's a huge hole. Somebody once told me, right when you hit a big hole, the first thing you got to do is stop digging. We will invest in healthcare and education. We will set priorities and stick to them, and we will work to balance the budget no later than 2017-18. Yes, friends, I know that's in our second term, but it's going to take that long to get things back on track. I mentioned earlier that every man, woman, and child in the province of Ontario is in debt by $17,000 per person based on these numbers right now. Liberals talk about the past, I hear Sudak. I'm here to talk about the present and, of course, project the future. Friends, our goal is to make Ontario Canada's leader in private sector job creation once again, from reducing taxes on families and workers to more affordable energy prices. We will focus on letting the job creators, not the government, drive new job growth. For small business, we will eliminate job killing red tape. We will reduce Ontario's business tax to 10% and fix the apprenticeship system to put more skilled workers on the job. And lastly, friends, a Tim Hudak-led BC government will treat all workers with fairness, equality, and respect. You know, personally, friends, I feel that it is completely disrespectful for public sector unions to tell their membership how to vote. Dalton McGinney has afforded them pay increases greater than the private sector jobs. So who pays? It's the private sector that carries the additional tax burden to not only to those inflated wages, but also to many of those union bosses who will receive fat bonuses as a result. This is Dalton McGinty's way of buying votes. This is just not right. When Dalton McGinty was asked about the e-health scandal with $1.2 billion wasted and paid out to friends and relatives, he responded by saying this, and I quote, "Well, if the people of Ontario don't like it, they can show it in the next election," unquote. Mr. McGinty, you are making the voting Ontario families an offer they can't refuse. So friends, I would ask that on October 6th, that you vote Rick Nichols to become your next MPP, and Tim Hudak and I will lead a PC government. Tim will lead in Toronto, the province, but I will lead in Chatham-Kent-Essex. I thank you for your thank you for your time. And let's bring Chatham-Kent-Essex back to life again. Thank you.
First off, I would like to thank the community for hosting the event, and I'm really happy to see so many people come out, and so the leaders' debate is tonight. And I may not be a professional public speaker or a lawyer, but I hope that I was able to get key points across from the NDP and how we best represent you here in Chatham-Kent-Essex. Myself, as well as the Ontario New Democrats, are giving you a real choice in this election for real change. We promise to take the HST off hydro, home heating, start taking it off gasoline, instead of handing billion-dollar tax breaks to the wealthiest people in the province. The Ontario New Democrats will reward companies that create and protect good jobs instead of making no strings attached tax giveaways to companies that are shipping jobs away. We will hire more doctors and nurses and tackle wait times in emergency rooms and stop the six-figure pay hikes to CEOs in the boardroom. But more than that, I am applying to this position to be your next member of the provincial parliament because I care about fighting for what we deserve in our community. Federal Conservatives and provincial Liberals can go on about all the great things their parties have done, but what have they done for us here in our riding? Policies that work well in larger city centers may be great for places like Toronto, but we don't seem to see the benefits trickle down here. And that's why I'm running. What I want to do is make sure that I bring your concerns, your issues, up to the people in power so that I can represent you more effectively. I'm hoping that you will choose me to be your next MPP because I am smart, I'm dedicated, I'm passionate, I'm determined, and I'm bound to make great changes here in our riding. So please vote for me on October 6th. And I'm not done. I know you're all kind of tired and wanting to get out of here, but I have to tell you, we have been doing really, really well in this election. If you guys have gone to Chatham at all, it's like we have swept Chatham in an orange wave. You guys should really come check out our office. It's 161 King Street, Chatham. And we have had a huge upswell of support. 20 to 30 new volunteers that have come out in the past 2 months. And really excited, like 18 to 35 year olds. People that have just decided all of a sudden to take time off their jobs to help with the campaign. people that have been laid off deciding to just spend all their time on the campaign. And we're making a lot of noise. If you guys are on the computer, check out Chatham-Kent-Essex.com, all one word. That's got all the community stuff that we've been doing around Chatham and Leamington and Bridgetown and all that. And basically, like, all the stuff that I would like to do for you as an MPP, but showing you that I'm already out in the community and I'm involved in the community and trying to see what your issues are already. So, anyway, I think you guys should all join me on my winning team. Come by our office, come grab an orange crush when you can, and right on our wishing wall, we have a wall where everybody writes down what they're hoping to change during the next election. And I'm going to take it to my office when I get elected, put it on the wall so I remember what everybody wanted and why everybody had voted me in. So, anyway, vote for me, Aleksandra Navarro, October 6th, if you have not done the advanced polling yet. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the candidates for coming this evening. I'd like to thank everybody who did come this evening. It's a pleasure to see as many people out as came out. I'm quite certain that if you come up to this meeting tonight, you probably intend to vote. I would ask you to, anybody that you know, maybe isn't going to vote, get them out to vote. I mean, it's people are hard for the right to do it, and people should respect that. Norm worked really hard today, taking more bits. So I got coffee and tea. I'm hoping that you all have a safe trip home. It's nice to nice to have a debate like this.
Jobs are never done.
Yeah, I know. It's brutal. Anyway, safe trip home. Thanks for coming.
Hey, thanks for watching the live streaming. I hope you guys got some good information out of this debate, and I hope you enjoyed some of the yelling matches that we had going on here. So, see you soon.
Do I say anything to our web audience?
Sure.
It's a pleasure to be in the Highgate for the debate tonight.
I watched the debate before I came here. Just to move out and everywhere.
Thanks, Paul. See if you want to say anything to the live audience.
We've had a live audience
yeah.
And I haven't decided.
black, or is that the actual?
Black bag.
Oh, that's an actual black bag. Oh, okay, I see. Yeah. I haven't seen one of those yet, so. Yeah, work pretty good, or?
Oh, yeah.
You like better the iPad or that?
I'm a black bag.
Oh, you're BlackBerry. My BlackBerry, I had one the same model. Within 3 months, I went through three of them. My brother went through a different one, like three of them in like 5 months. We said forget it. I was tired of them. But I think it was certain models.
Say bye to you, so have a good night, guys.